Hello, welcome everybody to today's webinar on WSO2 Micro Integrator. We'll be focusing on the graphical support for ESB and microservices style integrations. And my name is Sasikala Kotegoda, and I'll be joined by Prabhushi Samarakon, and we are both associate technical leads of the integration team of WSO2. So before we start on the content, let me tell you some important details. So questions can be submitted to us at any time during this webinar, and we'll be answering each one of them, as many as possible actually, at the end of the webinar. And a recording of this webinar will be made available through the official site of WSO2 webinars page a couple of days after the webinar. And let me take you through the content we'll be discussing today. First of all, I will be taking you through the evolution from WSO2 Enterprise Service Bus to the WSO2 Micro Integrator. Next, I'll be talking about the cloud native support we have in WSO2 Micro Integrator. The rest of the webinar will be a demonstration carried by Prabhushi. And first of all, we'll be focusing on the dedicated drag and drop design support with the WSO2 Integration Studio. And we'll be conducting another demonstration on the Docker and Kubernetes support via our tool. So let me introduce or reintroduce you to WSO2 Micro Integrator. So Micro Integrator is a platform, a solution that gives you, provides you a solution to your integration problem, where you want an enterprise service bus kind of a solution, where you want to integrate multiple services that are communicating heterogeneous protocols. So maybe here you might be expecting us to integrate cloud-based applications. Maybe you have some legacy applications or databases, file-based systems, or SaaS kind of applications that you want us to integrate. So the WSO2 Micro Integrator fits exactly here as an enterprise service bus. Also, on the other end, Micro Integrator enables you to integrate services in the microservices architecture, and also it provides you solutions anywhere in between. So let's say you're an organization which is turning from the SOA kind of integrations to microservices for the microservices architecture. So we'll be helping you to integrate your services in order to go to the microservices architecture. So let me take you through the evolution of WSO2 MI. WSO2 first had its ESB, WSO2 Enterprise Service Bus, which was the solution we gave for the SOA kind of problems. And then in the middle, we identified that the technology was moving with the cloud native trends. So we introduced the micro integrator profile that went inside the WSO2 Enterprise Integrator along with the ESB profile. So at that time, we had the WSO2 ESB for ESB kind of solutions and the micro integrator profile for cloud native solutions. Later on, what we realized was that the micro integrator profile, or rather what we extracted it as a separate product lately. And then we realized that the micro integrator itself, the product itself, can be modified to cater to both worlds. So what we have right now is the micro integrator product inside WSO2 EI, that is the enterprise integrator. So let me tell you how the micro integrator, WSO2 micro integrator, fits into the traditional integration solutions. So this is basically based on the same Synapse engine, just as the WSO2 ESB that has been in use for decades. This is based on the Synapse engine, and that will be used for the message transformation and routing and mediation. Therefore, there is no issue in that aspect. So let me take you through the developer workflow you would be following while you're using micro integrator for your traditional ESB kind of solutions. So once you have set up your environments with So what we provide for you, what we provide you for the developer workflow is the Integration Studio. That is the dedicated tool specifically designed for developing artifacts in the Micro Integrator. So once you have set up the tools like the Integration Studio, you would be implementing your integration logic using the Integration Studio. When I say the integration logic, this includes the artifacts that are required for message mediation or routing or transformation. So once you develop this the integration artifacts, you would be building and running them using the Integration Studio. So when I say building them, so if you are familiar with the WSO2 ESB, so what you will be having is a set of artifacts. So it's not practical to build each one of these separately. What we have is what's called a composite application, archiving almost all of these integration artifacts. So you could build the composite application and run it inside the Micro Integrator that is embedded in the Integration Studio itself. Once you have run it, what you can do is you can debug it and test it using the debugger that is in the Integration Studio itself. So let's say if you find out that you need to reiterate, you can go back to the development state, build, run, and iterate and improve until you're satisfied. And once you're satisfied with what you have, what you can do is you can commit the changes, you can commit your composite application to a version controlling system you are using. So once we are trying to use the Micro Integrator for traditional integration solutions, there are some significant feature gaps you would expect, but that are not there. So one thing is the hop deployment. This is something we had in the previous, the predecessor of the WSO2 Micro Integrator, that is the WSO2 Enterprise Service Bus. We have removed it from the Micro Integrator because we have identified that let me tell you what hot deployment is. Hot deployment is like the capability of modifying the runtime while the server is up and running. So we have removed the hot deployment capabilities in Micro Integrator because we have identified that there are inconsistencies when we are performing rolling updates. And another thing is, we have removed the management console that was there in the previous Enterprise Integrator. We have moved it to a CLI and a monitoring dashboard. So this is not a management dashboard, rather a monitoring dashboard. And we have made it that way because we wanted to prevent artifacts from being changed at the runtime once again. And another feature that will be missing is the task coordination. So when you're using the Micro Integrator as a product with multiple nodes, you would be expecting these Micro Integrators to work with coordination. That means like you will be expecting them to, when maybe for a single task to be scheduled only in one node. But this is something that we are missing in Micro Integrator, and we are expecting this to be included in the next release of my WSO2 Micro Integrator. So that is about how the Micro Integrator fits into the world of ESB. And let me tell you how the Micro Integrator fits into the world of microservices. So in the microservices architecture, you would be having small tasks that are communicating in live protocols, each running autonomously. So if you're a company that is moving from the traditional SOA architecture to the microservices, you would be still having some proprietary and legacy systems or maybe cloud applications that need to be integrated. Also, these microservices will be developed within teams, and these microservices still could be using multiple protocols. So whenever there are multiple protocols, the integration problem still exists, and that there comes the role of the micro integrator. Also, what we can do is we can expose these services as composite services. That is the other aspect of the micro integrator in the world of microservices. So when we are going to the microservices, we have to consider about some cloud native features because they are related together. So in the world of cloud, having a lower size is really important because it reduces the time to pull up images and things like that. So we have my WSO2 Micro Integrator is around 150 megabytes, and we are trying to reduce the size even more. And the micro integrator starts up in a very low time, like 4 seconds, and we are even trying to improve this time, because this is really crucial when it comes to environments like Kubernetes. Also, in the cloud native environment, what is expected is for the products to be immutable. That is once again because we have, as I told you earlier, we have identified that there are issues when rolling updates and things like that are happening in multiple environments. And another thing is, so we have introduced a feature called parameter injection as environment variables. So when we say we allow parameter injection as environment variables, you would be able to use the same immutable image across environments and have some variables parameterized, like the dynamic endpoints. So the dynamic endpoints will change from staging environments to QA environments to production environments. So what you can have is you can have your artifacts with the environment key, the key of the environment variable, and the value of the environment variable can be injected, and they will differ from environment to environment. Also for static configurations where the configurations could change, like the passwords or the keys to allocations. So we have parameterized them to be so that they can be injected as environment variables. So if I brief you through how we create a Docker image, so in the immutable nature, what we give you is a Docker image, and how we create it is using the Docker project. So there's something called a dedicated Docker project in the inside WSO2 Integration Studio. What you would be doing is you would be configuring the base image, the location of the base image, and the composite application that you have created. So the Docker image, the Docker project will output you the immutable image, the immutable Docker image, which contains where you have the integration artifacts, the composite applications burned into the micro integrator. When I say you can pull the Docker image, the micro integrator base image from the Docker image, from the Docker registry, you can decide which registry to use. So if you're a person without a subscription, you can pull the latest micro integrator image from the Docker hub. And if you have a valid WSO2 subscription, you can have the latest update with all the fixes from the private registry we host in WSO2. So when you're trying to deploy WSO2 Micro Integrator in Kubernetes, what you would give is the Docker image that you have created. So you would be inputting the Docker image, and you would be creating a Kubernetes project using this Docker image, and as the output, it will be deployed in the Kubernetes cluster. So the important aspect at this part is that you don't have to manually go and configure the deployment YAML or the service YAML. So in the Kubernetes project that is there in the Integration Studio, we have created an operator so that you can simply configure a single YAML file called the integration CRYAML and specify the number of replicas and pods you need, so that the creation of the services YAML and the deployment YAML is automated. So if I brief you through the parameter in injection as environment variables, so this is what it means. So this explains a situation where you have dynamic address endpoints. So in the staging environment, you would have one address URI, a mock URI maybe, and in the production environment, you will be having the actual environment. But in the base Docker image, you would see what you see on your left, an endpoint configuration containing the address URI as $system variable name. So the variable, the value of the variable will vary from the environment to environment, but the Docker image itself will be immutable and it will be the same in each environment. Also on the right side, you can see a situation where we have changed the configuration in that way. So if I take you through the developer workflow for the cloud native applications, this is pretty much the same as the developer workflow for the traditional integrations, where you set up your integration studio, and in addition to the integration studio, you might be needing to configure Docker and kubectl. So, and you develop the integration logic or the integration artifacts in the same way as before. Then you would be building the composite application and running them inside the embedded micro integrator, and you would be iterating and improving until you're done. And then you'd have the capability to decide whether you're going to expose publish a composite application or whether you're going to publish a Docker image itself as your artifact. So that is where the difference is when we have gone to the cloud native applications. Next, Prabhushi will be taking you through a demonstration on how to create Docker images and Kubernetes deployments using the Integration Studio. Thank you.
So as Sasikala mentioned, WSO2 Integration Studio provides a set of features to support container native capabilities of our WSO2 Micro Integrator. So there are basically two ways to create a Docker image using Integration Studio. One way is using the embedded Micro Integrator inside the Integration Studio. And the second way is to use the Micro Integrator base image from a Docker registry. And we will be discussing the latter one in detail in this webinar later. So let's look into the Docker image creation with the embedded micro integrator first. So by default, Integration Studio 1.0.7.0.0 version is already embedded with the micro integrator 1.1.0 version. That means when you are using this option, you will be basically creating a Docker image with the micro integrator 1.1.0 version. However, this approach is recommended only for testing purposes because if there are more complicated scenarios where you need to change the configurations, for example, let's say if we want to change the access to XML, then we need to manually go to the MI location within the Integration Studio and change the deployment YAML file. So for an end user, this will be a bit of a tedious task. That's why we are not recommending it for a complex scenario. So Integration Studio provides tooling capabilities to design, develop, test, and deploy your integration scenarios for WSO2 to ESB, EI, as well as for micro integrator series. So it is basically consistent with the set of project types, resources, artifacts to develop your integration scenario. So if you need more details on Integration Studio, you can follow our webinar series on Integration Studio, where you can get a more detailed or granular level details of the features of Integration Studio. So let's see how we can use the embedded micro integrator and create a Docker image using Integration Studio. So let's take our sample template, Hello World. We can click Hello Project using our template. So here in Integration Studio, we get the list of mediators where we can simply drag and drop and create our own integration solution. So let's add a custom log to our Hello World. We are using the log mediator. We can simply drag and drop there, drop onto the design view, and let's add a property, like a custom property, to our log mediator. Then once we select it, this is our composite application, and we can simply right click on our composite application and click on generate Docker image. There we get a wizard with three options. One is to create a new Docker project, and the second one is to use the embedded micro integrator inside the integration studio, and the third option is to use a Docker image, Docker project that is already there in your workspace. So for this option, we will be using the second one, and let's go ahead with the embedded micro integrator. Let's proceed with this option. So it will ask you to give a name for your Docker image and image tag, and also you have to give the file location to add your car application. And here you can select all the required artifacts to your Docker image. Once you click on finish, down there in the task bar, you can see the progress of the Docker creation. So once it is done, we will get a pop-up with the ID of your created image. And if you check on the local repository, we can see the new Docker image has been pushed to your local repository. So let's simply run our Docker image. Let's publish our path through transport port, which is 6290. And once it is started, we can see the pass through HTTP pass through transport is available in 8294. We can simply invoke our service. So now we can see our custom message has been logged in our console, and also the expected response has been received at the curl command. So if we take a more complex scenario, for example, let's take a manufacturing company needs to process their orders. These orders are queued in a, let's say, in active MQ queue, where the micro integrator needs to listen to that queue and take whenever an order arrives at the queue. And also micro integrator needs to send this message to the backend service where it will be processed. And once it is processed, it needs to send it to one of their database for storing purposes. Let's see how this is be done using our Docker project. So so let's first create a solution project using Integration Studio. It's actually a collection of projects where we get to select the required set of projects for this particular solution project. Here we will be creating the composite project and composite project along with the Docker project. So here we have to give a image target repository and also a tag for the target image. And also if you have any environment variables to be added to a Docker image, you can add it here. And for now we won't be adding any environment variable. So this is our config project. This is the composite application, and here this is the Docker exporter project. So if we look more closely to our Docker project, you can see there's a libs directory. This is basically used to add any third-party libraries that should be added in the micro integrator lib directory when we are creating the micro the Docker image with our micro integrator. And also after that we get the resources directory, which is basically to hold all the configuration files that cannot be configured using the deployment.toml file. Basically, all the configurations, for example, access to XML, carbon XML, all these frequently used configurations can be configured through the deployment TOML file. But in cases where if you need to add a new configuration file, or if you need to configure secure world where we will be changing a couple of files, we need to add those configurations onto this under this resources directory. So deployment file, TOML file is to basically configure all the access to carbon XML related configuration. This is actually a single point of configuration file where the user only needs to change this TOML file so that it will be configured at the MI level. So then we have the Docker file where we will be defining all the Docker image related configurations. And also in the POM file, we can select all the composite applications for your Docker image. So first, let's create a proxy service, which will be acting as the JMS listener for Micro Integrator. So let's name it as order service, and we will be configuring the JMS transport for this proxy. So once it is added, we now need to configure our JMS transport for the Micro Integrator through our access to XML. So for that, we have to basically change the TOML file accordingly. So first, let's start an ActiveMQ Docker container. So if we check the images, now we have ActiveMQ image. Let's run our ActiveMQ container, publishing the JMS transport ports as well as the web console port. So once it is started, we can see the web console URL. So if we go to this port 8161 in our browser, we can see the ActiveMQ has been started. So let's inspect this container, and let's get the IP address of this particular container, because we need that to configure our access to XML configuration. So if we go through our documentation, you can see how to configure the access to JMS listener in access to using our TOML file. You can simply copy these configurations into the TOML file, deployment TOML file, and change the IP address according to the container IP. Likewise, we can configure topic listener, queue listener, as well as we need to have a default JMS listener configuration in our access to XML. So once this is done, in order to make the JMS listener works, we need to add all the ActiveMQ related client libraries. We need to add them into the Micro Integrator lib directory. So for that, we can simply copy and paste required libraries onto the libs directory in our Docker project. So let's take the next step where we need to call the backend endpoint to process our order detail. So let's add our call mediator and an endpoint. And in this scenario, let's assume the backend endpoint differs depending on the environment, where they need to have a dynamic value as the backend endpoint for maybe for dev and prod environment. So basically, we will be using dollar system keyword to configure and system variable. So once it is configured in the Docker file, we can define it as an environment variable. So it will be applied while creating the Docker image. So for the next step, we need to send the response to their database. So for that, we will be using the DB report mediator. And for that, let's configure the database using. First, let me start our MySQL container. Let's start the container first. Then if we go inside the container, and if we log into our MySQL console, then we can, so here I am using the manufacturing company database, and if we go and select all the entries that are there in the table, now we can see there are two entries available at the table now. So once again, we need to get the IP address of this particular MySQL container to configure it at our DB report mediator. So let's inspect and grab the IP address. So if we go back to the Integration Studio, then we can go to configure and we can select our database connection type. And if we select the version, we can simply download the my database clients are here. So once it is configured, we can add the configuration details and we can test for the database here. Here first I'm just trying to connect to the local host machine, but we have to change, if we change the IP according to the container IP, now we can connect to the DB connection correctly. So once we download the client jars using the configure option in the DB report mediator, it will basically download the client jar onto your workspace. So if we refresh on the project, you will get a new directory called dependencies with the relevant jar. So you can simply copy from there and you can paste it in the libs directory of our Docker project so that it will be applied to our Docker image. So even though we configured, we have here actually hard-coded the password in within the Synapse configuration. So that is not a good practice when we are developing the artifact. So the best way is to configure the password using the secure vault option in micro ESB. So basically here we will be using a secret alias instead of hard coding the password. So it will be resolved at the runtime. So for that, when we are using secure vault with Docker, we have to basically configure a fresh pack of micro integrator. And we have to configure secure vault for that MI distribution, and we have to copy those change files onto our Docker image. So let's configure secure vault for a MI 110. So we have this cipher tool executor to configure secure vault for micro integrator. It will ask for the default key store password here. Once it is configured, we can encrypt our password. Let's give the secret alias. Then let's give the password. And you can see The secret alias along with the encrypted password has been added to the secure vault properties file. And also when we configure secure vault for micro integrator, it will basically change the conf security directory, some of the files within this directory, according to the cipher tool configuration. So when we are creating our Docker image, we should basically copy all the change files on to our resources directory. Let's copy them here, copy and paste them here. So here you can see I have added one more additional file called password temp file. Here we will we are basically having the password for our default key store of micro integrator, because when we are starting the micro integrator, it will be asking for the default key store's password, but in a Docker environment we cannot provide it from outside. If we, like, let's say if we are start running it as a daemon, for such cases we can simply have this temp file and it will be read at the server starter. So here the cipher tool properties file, this is actually is consisted with some XPath values for the change secured configurations, and also we have this secret conf properties file. Here we have to make sure the key store identity location has been configured corresponding to our base image of the micro integrator, because when we are running a secure vault in our local machine, the path will be set as an absolute path according to the host machine. So we have to change it according to the base image. And finally, we have the secure vault properties file, where our secret alias along with the encrypted password is there. So so once we copy all the files, we should copy them onto the base image using the copy operation in the Docker file. So we have to copy them for the corresponding locations of our MI. And also, since we have copied client libraries to our libs directory, we should uncomment the third line and we should make sure all the jars in the libs are copied to the MI lib directory. So once these are configured, let's go back and configure our DB report mediator. Now we can add our SQL query to be let's say an insert into our DB, MySQL DB, and also we can add some query parameters corresponding to the response coming from the backend order processing system. Likewise, we can add all the required parameters for our DB report mediator. And let's save this, and we will be adding a drop mediator at the end of integration flow to make sure the integration flow is being disabled, is being stopped at this point. So once we have configured it, we can go to the POM directory and select all the required composite applications for our Docker project. And then let's go to our composite project and make sure all the relevant artifacts are being selected. Let's save it. And we can right click on the Docker project and build Docker image. Here we will be basically building all the related Synapse artifacts, and also we will be creating the car file. And in addition to that, we will be running our MI container config mapper Maven plugin, which will be basically changing our configuration files according to the configurations defined in our deployment TOML file. And also after that, we will be running Dockerfile Maven plugin which will be applying all the Docker related configurations defined in the Docker file. So once it is done, if we go and refresh our Docker file, we can see the new configurations changes that are being added with our config mapper, which are actually defined in in the deployment terminal, are being added to the Docker file, so that the change file will be added to the base image while generating the custom Docker image. So if we check on the Docker images, we can see the new image has been added to our local repository. If let's run it as a daemon. So once it has started, let's go to our ActiveMQ console. Now we can see we have one consumer for the queue, and let's place an order in the queue. Okay, if we go back and check in our MySQL database table, we should be able to see the new entry that has been added to our table. So that's how we can use Docker native support with our Docker project while creating your custom integration solutions and create the Docker image. So WSO2 Micro Integrator comes with the Kubernetes EI operator, which is basically introducing this integration custom resource for the Kubernetes cluster. So this custom resource or the integration CR YAML file basically defines MI specific container orchestration configurations, such as configurations related to pod services, ingress control, etc. So that the end user does not need to manually configure Kubernetes configuration for WSO2 MI. So this integration custom resource is supported through the Kubernetes project in our integration studio. So first, when we are using this operator, first we need to clone our Git repository, Kubernetes EI operator, and we have to install it. So this is actually a one-time thing. You have to introduce our operator to the Kubernetes cluster. Here we have a new client called integration client, which is basically handle all these EI specific deployment configurations for MI the cluster. So let's start our Kubernetes cluster. Once it is started, we need to install our operator onto the cluster. So we can go to the operator location and install all the configuration YAML file. So if we check on the deployment, now we can see the operator has been installed there. And let's go ahead and create a Maven multi-module project. Let's name it as a Hello World parent project. Now let's add an ESB config project onto our Maven multi-module project. So let's add the simple Hello World proxy service into our config project. So let's add a payload factor mediator and define a custom payload. So we will be simply adding a respond media so that the payload that is defined in the payload factor mediator will be responded back to the client. So next, let's add a composite application for our Maven multi-module project. And we can select the projects, config projects that needs to be added there. And also let's add the Kubernetes project. It will ask for a Kubernetes project name, and also we can give an unique name for our integration kind there, and also we can configure the number of replicas or the pods to be defined, and also we have to give the target repository we have to push our Docker image, and also target image type. And if you need to add any environment variable, you can add it here as well. So once we create the Kubernetes project, we can select the composite applications to be added in our Docker image. If we look closely in our Kubernetes project, you can see it is pretty much similar to our Docker project. It is also consisted with the libs directory, resources, deployment toml, Docker file. Those are actually similar as the Docker image. The same configuration files are used there. In addition to that, we have this custom resource integration CRYAML file where we have defined our Kubernetes specific deployment detail. For example, here we have defined the service name. We are to pull the image under the image and the number of replicas. And once we configure everything, let's go ahead and build the Docker image. So it will ask to give your Docker repository. Here I'm using the Docker Hub. And if we give the username and password, then we can simply push the image from here. It will basically first build the artifact, then it will push the Docker image to our Docker Hub, the Docker repository you have defined, and also it will be added to our local repository. So hello service has been added to our local repository, and if we refresh our Docker Hub repositories, now we can see the service hello world service has been added there. So let's deploy this service in the Kubernetes environment. You can simply go to the our Kubernetes project location and apply the integration custom resource YAML. And let's, if we check the integration, get the integration operator specific details, then you can see the new service, hello world service is running, up and running. And also, in addition to the Kubernetes operator, now we have the hello world specific deployment. And also, if we check for the ingress control, it also have an ingress, EI operator ingress, because by default, EI operator does have a controller. We check for the services, then we can see the hello world service has been added in addition to the operator. And also let's try to invoke our hello world service. Here I'm actually skipping the ingress controller, so I'll be simply forward the pass-through port to the host machine. So so if we simply invoke our service using the pass-through port, you can see the desired output has been received at the terminal. So that's it about the container native support for Micro Integrator with Integration Studio. Actually, we have an upcoming webinar which will be discussing more details about our Kubernetes support and Kubernetes operator support for Micro Integrator in detail. You can join that and get more details on our operator. So that's all what we have on this webinar today. So thank you for joining, and we would be happy to answer if you have any questions.
So we have a question whether asking whether MI is part of the EI. Yes, so EI, the latest release of EI went with the micro integrator. So you can actually move from the EI, the ESB profile of EI to MI. But as I told you, the task coordination is still pending. But of course, if you are using EI in the cloud native world, you can definitely use MI. If you are using Kubernetes or something, you can definitely use the micro integrator. If you are using if you are planning to use micro integrator on the VM, there is a restriction in the task coordination as of yet.
And we have another question asking whether do we require subscription for using Docker and Kubernetes images? It is not mandatory. Actually, we have public images, base images at our Docker Hub. And in addition to that, we also have a private images as well, but still you can use our public images on our Docker Hub and use them with the Docker project and Kubernetes project.
There's another question asking whether this streaming integrator is compatible with the micro integrator. I suppose the question is whether you can integrate streaming integrator with the micro integrator. Yes, that's doable. And for publishing events from the streaming integrator to the micro integrator, we have actually a native support using gRPC. And for the next question asking whether you can do Siddhi operations in the integration studio, no, you have to use the dedicated web UI for that. So this, the integration studio is for writing artifacts for the micro integrator only. There's a question whether there'll be some link to download this video. Yes, the video will be available in the WSO2's official website of webinars. You can view it, but not probably download it.
And also there's another question, how to change offset by dynamic parameter. Actually, since it is configured at the carbon XML level, we can use the deployment toml to change the value, but it won't be applicable as the synapse level parameters, dynamic parameters. It will be applied globally at the carbon XML level.
There's another question asking what we use for creating artifacts for EI, whether there's an IDE for EI. So the integration studio is compatible with, so I suppose the question is about the ESB profile of EI. If that is the question, the integration studio is compatible with the,
it is actually backward,
yeah, compatible. It's backward compatible. You can use it with any of the EI versions. And there's a continuation of the previous question asking whether, so if we are not using any container services, we should use EI then. So it's like this, if task coordination is a prominent feature you might be requiring, then you might need to wait until the next release of the micro integrator, because the task coordination will be there. But if that is not a heavy use case of yours, you can actually move into the micro integrator. And it's also asking, saying that I am already using EI, which is deployed in Kubernetes. What are the advantages for me if I migrate to Micro Integrator? So as we told, the startup time of EI is a little bit high, somewhat higher than the Micro Integrator. We have optimized the Micro Integrator for the cloud native world. So the size is smaller and the startup time is lower. And we are making, so there are some ongoing improvements as well for the cloud native world. So it seems like we have run out of time. And we'll be wrapping up the session. Thank you very much for joining.